Welcome, welcome, welcome to today's top-rated seller webinars. We are so glad you're here to visit with us. Today's webinar is part of a monthly series of webinars geared to eBay sellers of all sizes. You don't have to be a top-rated seller to join us. The series is brought to you at no cost by our wonderful sponsors. And our sponsors are Billboards by PageMage. Make your eBay listing stand out to sell out. Brand your listings, advertise special offers, cross-sell items, and more across all of your listings. Billboards is one of the top 10 most popular applications in the eBay App Center, and it's completely free. Stamps.com. If you're selling online through multiple sales channels, shipping can be a headache. Not with Stamps.com. Stamps.com consolidates all of your orders so you can ship them out with ease. With one click, you can directly import all of your order data from the most popular online marketplaces, including eBay, Amazon.com, PayPal, and Etsy, plus the most popular shopping cart software. Outright, putting your accounting on autopilot. And Terapeak, because Terapeak sellers make more money on every sale. We're also sponsored by eBay Radio, where you've got the grip. Our hosts Jim Griff Griffith and Lee Mirabal impart eBay knowledge and education every Tuesday from 11 to 2 p.m. Pacific Time and every Thursday from 3 to 5 p.m. You can listen live or to the archives. Thank you all again for being here. Our very next webinar is going to be called Branding Your eBay Business and be presented by Dana Crawford and Chris Taylor. Please watch for the announcement of the date and sign up for our newsletter, so you'll be sure not to miss it. Sign up now at Top Rated Seller Webinars. These webinars are coordinated and hosted by Kat Simpson and Karen Locker of Ecom Connections. Sign up for their Ecom Connections newsletter for all the e-commerce connections you need to move your business to the next level. Stay connected with Top Rated Seller Webinars through our blog at topratedsellerwebinars.com. Go sign up for our newsletter. You can sign up on the blog, and it's free. You'll be the first to know about all the new plans for our webinar series. Also, join us on Facebook. Search for the Top Rated Seller Webinars group on Facebook. And now, a little housekeeping. First question is always, can this webinar is being recorded? And the answer is yes. The recording will be available as soon as it's cleaned up and ready on our YouTube channel. And you can, a link to this will be in the newsletter that you signed up for in our webinar and also on the follow-up email you'll receive from today's webinar. Will we distribute the presentation slides? Well, John, I think we will, won't we? We'll add the slides from John as a PDF on the topratedsellerwebinars.com site as soon as possible. If you're having audio problems and you're on the phone, our best advice is just to hang up and call back in. If you're having problems with the sound on your computer, our best advice is try using the phone number and call in for the best audio quality. And now we're ready for John Lawson. He is going to take us to Going Social, how to set up your eBay business. John, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
And you're ready to take over, aren't you?
Pretty much. Ready
okay.
to go.
Here we go. Thank you, John, for being here.
Yay. All right, so I'm going to show my screen, guys, and it's going to take a couple of minutes, so it's going to ask me, which screen do I want to show? And so, oh, it will share this screen. Fantastic. I think I wanted to share this screen. So, yeah, there we go. All right, it's going to share that screen. You guys let me know when you see my screen.
I can see your screen now, John. It looks great.
Fantabulous. You see the first slide going social?
I do, and I see that little QR code in the bottom, too.
All right. Fantastic, guys. So we're going to talk about going social. Now, I know a lot of people are already socially engaged. Some of us are having success. Some of us are not. Some of us are not even starting yet. But it doesn't matter where you're at. This is really for you. So, look, guys, everybody knows that social media is absolutely killing it as far as marketing on the internet is concerned. And today I'm going to show you really how easy social media actually is. And I know you want to get in on it because, of course, it's the gold rush. Everybody's moving so much product on social media. But the thing is, for some of us, it just doesn't seem like we're getting those right results. But that's what I'm going to show you. And I'm going to show you this today without having to learn about all the new technology or signing up for 1,000 different sites and spending hours tweeting or spamming your friends on Facebook. I don't think any of those are really great ways to get started in social media or to continue doing those kind of things if that's what you've been doing. But let's get back. Let's just kind of back up for a minute.
John, we lost your sound, babe. Can you come back to us? John, we've lost your sound. Are you there?
You don't hear. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you now. Go back a slide, and we lost you right about there.
Okay. So, I mean, we didn't lose anything. Basically, I'm still letting you know about what we're going to teach, guys. So, we are going to spend some time on how to really kill it in social media without spending hours and hours of your day spamming your friends, because that's just not cool. All right? But we're going to really deal with ways to make this easy and fast for you to do in your business. So we're just going to spend a little bit of time on the how-tos. But before we get into how-tos, how about we back up a minute and talk about this guy, John Lawson. Who is he? Why is he here? Why should we be listening to him? Well, you know what? Here's the bottom line. Is I used to sit in my office for hours in a day without really nothing to or no one to talk to. I would do my business on eBay, but I had nobody to really chat with. So I decided back in around 2008 to start playing on Twitter. And I got really engaged in that. I got really embraced by the community that was out there of eBay sellers and online merchants, and I got totally stuck on it. So much, in fact, that I ended up speaking about it publicly like I'm doing here today, and there's been a snowball of press and coverage and things like that, being able to be on TV and all this kind of cool stuff. But that's not the important part. The important part is that every day I, just like you, am trying to do some sales on the internet using these tools. I started my eBay store back in 2004. That's when the store started, but I actually started selling stuff on the internet way before that. This is one of those screen captures from way back when we first got started with our eBay store. And over the years, it's grown, it's changed, it's done a couple of things. Today, we have that little professional look that I've been wanting probably from day one. It's always been in my head. But that's our eBay store today. And look, guys, I'm not claiming to be an expert. I'm not claiming to be the greatest person that knows about eBay or social media. No, that's not who I am. I've got about 89,000 feedbacks on eBay. I've transacted over 120,000 eBay transactions alone. Of course, you know how that works, where most of the people that you transact with don't give you feedback. So if nothing else, I at least have enough experience to sit here and have you listen. So let's talk about you. Let me ask you guys a question. What do you really want out of your business? I mean, you're doing this business. Most of us are solopreneurs or entrepreneurs with small teams, and we really just want to be able to spend more time with our family and do more things with our family and make sure that they're secure in this very insecure financial environment. And also, every once in a while, it'd be nice to sit back and take maybe a vacation or just relax. And how we think we're going to do that is by getting more traffic. We want more traffic. I don't know anywhere else that traffic is a good word except for internet marketing and e-commerce. We want more traffic because we think basically that traffic represents more sales, and that's not a bad thought. Absolutely not. So we're going to talk about how social media is crushing it and it will help you get more qualified leads than most any other technique out there online for e-commerce marketing. And look, you've seen the stories. You know that most of the major brands are on social media. Are there a single brand that you can really think of that is a well-known brand that does not use some form of social media with either a YouTube channel, a Facebook, a blog, a Twitter? Why are all these people on social media? Because it works. So if you have some person coming up to you saying, ah, that social media stuff, that doesn't work, you know that for them it doesn't work, basically because they don't know what they're talking about. These guys, these major brands, would not be on social media spending this kind of money. It is the fastest growing money spend in enterprise business right now, social marketing, because it works, it's important, and if it's good enough for them, I say, you know what, it's good enough for me. All right, so let's get into some of this. One of the things that I hear a lot of smaller sellers, you know, talking about is that they don't believe that social media is good. They think it's a waste of time. Or they use the excuse that it's just throwing away money. It's too expensive, and I don't want to spend that kind of time and money doing those things. You know what I say to those guys? Absolutely. I think you're freaking right on point. Because you know what? I don't want you spamming me with your crap anyway. You know what I'm saying? And the other part is, it's an opportunity for me and you, because if we're the first ones out there and we're the market leaders, we have an advantage over the competition. So look at this picture. Is this your brand? Are you now simply spraying and praying with social media, where you just constantly are going into people's groups and posting your stuff that's on sale on your website or your eBay store or your Amazon place? Are you spamming your brand? And what impact will that have on your ability to market to the people you are trying to reach? If you're constantly spamming me with information, even if it's good information that I don't want, then that's still considered spam. And what happens to the human mind and to the brain is that we are very much conditioned to stop listening. And we don't want people to stop listening to our brand. And right now, that brand could just be you. And you don't want people giving you that kind of thumbs down. That's not the way to get them to the shopping cart. And that's what we are trying to do. So I'm not going to give you a whole lot of puff and fluff. I want to give you the absolute 1,000% truth. And so let's get one thing straight. Social is way more valuable to businesses when people are buying and using your products than it is for them to just talk about it. Talk is cheap. Show me the money. If there is no money in it, then why are we doing it, right? And that's where people sometimes get it wrong. They just, you know what? Somebody's talking about you. Yeah, right? And as long as it's just somebody talking about you, most of the times you want to know, why are they talking about me? Why are they all in my business, right? Talk is cheap. We want people that are actually using our products and buying our products. We want to spend our effort. If we're looking at the 80-20 rule, we want to spend 20%. I'm sorry. We only want to spend 20% of our time doing the things that are going to give us the biggest part of our results. All right? Did I say that? I said that completely backwards. The problem is that most of the time, our effort that we put in give us less results than we should. So we're going to flip it around now, where I'm going to let you spend only 20% of the current effort you're spending today and get 80% more results. All right? So the first thing I want you to learn about social media is that it's not a slam dunk. Social media is not like the greatest basketball player, in my opinion, ever, Michael Jordan. It's not like Mike. social media is a lot more like Scottie Pippen, all right? And Scottie was a very important part of that team as he would set up that, you know, offense and make the defense come towards him so he could pass the ball off to Mike. And that's what social media is, in my opinion. It's a great ball passer. It's a great handoff. This guy that created this thing called Facebook, you know Zuckerberg, he said back at the end of 2010 that if he had to guess, social commerce would be the next thing to blow up. And it was basically a no-brainer. A lot of people's like, oh, yeah, that makes so much sense. It's going to be easy. I've got an online retail store. Somebody buys a product. They share it with a friend. That friend's going to make that, take that recommendation. They're going to click through to that retailer, and boom, all of a sudden, our traffic's going to increase. Our conversion rates are going to go through the roof. We're going to drive so much traffic, we can't even begin to understand. But that's not necessarily what happened. What happened was we kind of got confused about what social commerce was. Was social commerce supposed to be us integrating the tools on top of our e-commerce site and engaging the customers there? Or was it supposed to be selling our products and services on social media? We didn't really know. One thing we did know, though, is that Fantasy Island opened up the day that Mark Zuckerberg made that comment. If you just look at the Google Trends, the day after he made that comment, all of a sudden social commerce took off as a search term, and it's been a search term. It's been in our lexicon ever since. I don't know which one actually came first, the chicken or the egg. I don't know. But one thing I do know is that we are here. This is real, and it's actually working. So let's take a quick look at the top spots for marketing your e-commerce business. And this is a poll that was asked of online marketers about where you are actually marketing today. And if you look, 88% of them are currently using Facebook. Another 6% are planning on using it this year. After that comes Twitter, then LinkedIn, blogs, YouTube, forums, Flickr, on and on and on. All right? Fantastic. So we do see that marketing is going on and that people are using those tools. It's like the $6 million man. You remember that show a long time ago? It's like we have the technology. But the problem is we never asked why are we building these things just because the technology's there? Yeah. Oh, I get it. So we started building everything. We didn't even ask why we're building it. We're just building it because we have the technology. And what we ended up looking for were all these soft and fuzzy things. We wanted friends. We wanted people to like me. Ooh, could you pin that for me? You know? Oh, I got a new Twitter follower. Those are all soft. What do I mean by soft? Well, that means simply that those things do not necessarily translate into any real active relationship with the person that is following you, friending you, pinning something, or liking you. And those are soft relationships. And we spent too much time focusing on that kind of process of getting soft, you know, fuzzies, and not enough on the strategy. There was never any thought about the target audience. So when somebody comes to me and says, you know, man, I tried that, and I'm like, well, what did you try? Well, I was posting up all of my auctions from eBay, and I got some looks, but I really didn't get any sales. And I'm like, really? Well, you're kidding me. You mean you've posted all that crap on your Facebook thread and nobody bought? Wow, I can't believe that. Of course not. Give me a break. That's not going to work. That's not what this is about. What we want, guys, in e-commerce is we want the hard. We want the hard stuff. We don't want the soft stuff. It's very easy to tell if somebody is actually doing what we want them to do in social media. We need to see the money. We can rank on whether somebody is converting. We can get good analytics on the number of transactions that we're having, the average order volume, the cart size. These are hard analytics. And those are the kind of things that you and I, as e-commerce people, need to be tracking to see if our social campaign, our social marketing strategy is working. Friends, likes, followers, those are cool too, but understand those are just soft metrics. The hard metrics are the ones that will bring the top and bottom line up where we want it. The first thing I want to really give to you and talk to you about is that there's a perception gap between the consumer or the customer and the business. And if you look at this chart very carefully, at least the two red things. On the consumer side, consumers are interacting with companies on social media for the top two things, getting discounts and making purchases. However, if you look on the right-hand side, people in our industry think that people are on these social sites to learn about new products or get general information. And you look all the way down to where we as merchants think we should be focusing in social media, and we've got what the top two things that the consumer thinks are important for social media. That's really, really a big gap. It's a perception gap, and we've got to close that. And today, you, just by seeing this, are getting ready to close that. You are having a great opportunity just by listening to some of the stuff that we are going to share on this webinar. So we're about halfway through the slides, and you know what? You've hung out this long. I want to give you a gift. Right now, just write this down, or for some of you, because I know we have a lot of multitaskers with multiple windows open, go for it. Go to goingsocial.colderice.com, and you can download the Pinterest 101 cheat sheet, which will help you get up and going and growing a crowd on Pinterest, which I think, personally, is a good, I wouldn't say pure play for e-commerce, but it's very close to becoming a good pure play e-commerce platform as it develops over time. What you want to do right now is get it set up, get it ready, get it in the right manner so that when we see the traffic that we're going to see, you know, everybody's talking about, oh, Pinterest is growing so fast. It's got 18 million uniques, all that kind of stuff. I'm going to tell you one thing about Pinterest is that the bulk of Pinterest users do not even know it exists yet. Let me say that again. The bulk of Pinterest users do not even know it exists yet. And that's why I think it is important for you to get it set up in the proper manner. And this is a good cheat sheet for you. So that's a gift. That's a gimme. You're welcome. All right, let's continue on here. What we're going to deal with now is we're going to get a little bit deep now. All right, let's get into the actual process of what the Going Social is all about. Okay? What you want to find out, and you see over here I've got three arrows, okay? The first arrow is that big yellow arrow, which should be on your right of the screen, I guess. Yeah, it's on your right, all right? And that's going up. So that just lets you know that this is we're going to go from the bottom to the top. Then I've got two arrows on the left-hand side, a green arrow and a red arrow. The red arrow is what I want you to stop doing. What most of us do is we get a message, and we fire it off. Hey, I got a message, fire. Message, fire. Message, fire. Message, spam, 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 spam. Right? What I want you to do now is go down and start at the green arrow. So this is what this Going Social is going to be all about. It's going to be about finding the audience first, figuring out the channel that the audience is actually on, so that you can participate and speak to them in the manner in which they want to be spoken to. After you have those two things, then you can craft a message, and when you fire, it's going to be on point. And that's how you're going to get the conversion and the hard metrics that you and I, as e-commerce people are looking for. Here's something that you maybe never seen before. Probably not, because I just put it together on this slide. But it's dandelion social model. And if you look in the center, that big W, that's WordPress. That's a blog. All right? I prefer WordPress, but there are other blog platforms. And that's in the center of the model. Around the outside are YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, and the first social marketing platform on the web, email. I know. You never hear anybody that's in social ever talk about email. But email is one of the best converting. See, this is one of the best converting mediums out. It's still, yes, I understand people don't open their emails anymore. Yes, I understand all that, blah, blah. Email is dead. Social media killed it, blah, blah. I don't care what you say. For us in e-commerce, email is the best converting platform. But you can't just spam people in email. So we're going to use the hub and spoke model. So if you look at this dandelion and if you take those little circles off the tops, that would represent the hub and spoke model. But if you put the little other parts on top, that makes it a dandelion model. And what's happening is that these channels will be able to feed other channels. So if I make a YouTube video, it actually would have other channels that it would feed, like my Facebook, my Twitter, and it would actually be posted on my website or my blog. You see what I'm saying? So that's why we have these other channels that actually get fed, but all of them start, and the hub of it all is a blog. Let's go into it even deeper. How about Facebook? How do we use it? Facebook, if you got a Facebook fan page, one of the things you've got to do is keep it current. Now, that depends, and the dictates are on your audience, but people don't come back to a static Facebook fan page, okay? So one of the things about Facebook that is a requirement, basically, for you to be successful is it has to stay current. You need to get content weekly, at least. Every week, something new needs to be coming out, and you can get that kind of content from your blog feed, which is a great way to make sure that you're taking your blog and feeding that content into your Facebook page. At least that will keep it up to date and current. Up to date, do some updates on the go. The cool thing about Facebook and Twitter are these are things that you can do from your iPad, your iPhone, things like that while you're on the move. And people love photos, pictures, and images. I know you caught that, right? Those are all the same things. Photos, photos, photos. The reason why Pinterest is so engaging is photos. The reason why Facebook paid all those billions for Instagram is for what? Photos. Photos are very important to Facebook. As a matter of fact, here is a fact, is that photos are the number one liked thing on Facebook. Here's something you may not know about. How do you find the conversation on Facebook? Well, you do a search. Have you ever taken the time to do a search for a product? I'm doing a search here for a product, socks. Let's say I sell socks. You'll get some results, but that red box at the bottom of the results, have you ever clicked on that? Click on that one day for your product where it says see more results, and you'll get a whole nother screen. And that screen will allow you to filter. And what I filter in on are pages that have to do with whatever that thing is that I'm looking for. I'm looking, remember, for the audience, the bottom part of our pyramid. I want to find out where they are, what they're talking about, so I know how to target that audience. And pages on Facebook are a lot of times where people are talking about those kind of products. So do a search, do the more results, and then check out the pages, sort on that filter, and you'll get a lot of great information. Also, photos, again, are important on your Facebook fan page. or your timeline page is what they're calling them now. All right? I think this one's nice. This one's from another. I've got three of them here. These are all small business owners, and I think these have just a little bit of flavor that make you interested enough to scroll down. All right? That's what really the whole web is becoming about. Everybody knows they have to scroll down, so we're leveraging the top half of the page to get them interested, and you do that with photos. So this is a great photo. I like the way it looks, feels, and it makes it engaging. I like this website. Very engaging. Of course, I'm interested in Bruce Lee sitting there in the middle of the top, you know. But the way it's laid out, the color schemes, the professionalism, small seller, great store, fan page, very engaging. This one right here, she's killing it. Look, just take a look at how many likes she has on this page. I know this young lady. I met her the first year I went to Australia. She told me that first year, she's like, John, great stuff. I enjoyed what you said about social media. I really hadn't thought about it before I heard you. Now, this was 4 years ago. And ever since, she keeps coming back and telling me, man, I'm doing what you said. I'm doing what you said. And every year I come back, she takes more of this information. She puts it into her fan page, and she's got 47,000 likes on this fan page. She uses this fan page to launch product. She's literally selling product using this fan page. She goes out and sources product. Hey, do you guys like this? Would you buy it? They'll like it up, or they'll say, man, or they'll show no interest in it. She doesn't carry it. She doesn't create the product for it. But one of the things that Tragic Beautiful knows is she knows her customer base, and they are very interactive with her. She's an eBay seller in Australia. You should check out her blog page or fan page and definitely give it a like and tell her I sent you. Okay? Let's move on to the next one, Twitter. It's a great place to share industry news. It's a great place to get industry news. It's a fantastic place to spy on your competition and find out what is interesting and current in your industry. And of course, you can build your followers. What's the tool that you have to have for Twitter? Easy. The search. Go to search.twitter.com and find out right now what's happening around your product, your brand, or your industry. That's one thing you should be doing. I don't care. Don't ever tweet anything. The value in Twitter is not about tweeting. It's about listening and joining the conversation. This search.twitter.com is probably one of the most powerful tools on Twitter and probably one of the least used ones. How about blogs? Well, we already talked about how the blog is the hub. How often do you need to be blogging? I recommend 2 or 3 times a week. Oh, I know, that's so much time. No, it's not. What I do, and this is how I do it, and you know I've got a blog. If you don't, it's over there at Colder Ice. The deal is, on most occasions, I will spend about 2 hours a week on my blog, and I will set it up on time frames where it will take a story, and I'll write 2 or 3 stories, and I'll just push them out there with a timer on it so that it'll come out on Monday, Wednesday, Friday. And now that gives fresh content every week. If you're not blogging, you have to start now. You really do. You have to start now because blogs are so important to keywords. They are fantastic for getting you ranked on your keywords around your business. And that is one of the biggest strategies and probably one of the first strategies we will talk about in this next phase of Going Social that will be coming out next month. So blogging is the center of your social thing. And in order to know exactly how to rank, you gotta first do your keyword research. And of course, you should have already done that for your titles of your auction items on eBay anyway. Here's a great tool, and this is the one I use. It's called Scribefire. Scribefire makes a version for pretty much every major I just drew a blank. For every major, what are those things called? Web browsers.
Oh. Browser. There you go.
Thank you. Yeah. So for every major web browser, there is a version of Scribefire. And what this is kind of cool, it links into your blog, but it allows you to do a blog post right inside of your web browser as opposed to having to take that clunky back end of some of these WordPress blogs, okay? And let me just be clear for clarity. When I talk about WordPress blog, I'm not talking about the free version. I'm talking about the hosted version. The free version has a lot of limitations when it comes to commerce. And that, remember, guys, is what we're focused in on, is making money. You can't make money with a free blog. It's illegal, you know, or at least illegal on their terms, okay? So, but any rate, get the Scribefire. It's free. It's a great download. Connects to your blog and makes blogging extremely simple with a WYSIWYG and a feel like Microsoft Word. Cool. Our next big gun is YouTube. I can't say enough about YouTube. As a matter of fact, I'm going to spend the rest of my time probably dealing with some YouTube stuff. Why? Because YouTube is top ranking for SEO. Top ranking for SEO. It's the most shared content on the web. I said that the most shared or the most liked content were photos. The most shared content on the web are videos. All right? The cool thing about videos is that they are being watched all the time on mobile platforms, and they're easy to make. Very easy to make as long as you keep the KISS principle in your mind. Keep it simple, stupid. That would make That's what makes it so easy. The other day, I'm doing some research for this, and I'm like, you know, let's see what one of the biggest newspapers in the country have to say about social media. And this story just came out recently about how brands are listening to social media to get products. And this is a great story about how these products, this one lady right here that they're showing here, is that she would find, I guess women are really attached to their lipstick. You know, if you find a lipstick that you like, then you use it all the time. Or if you find a cologne or a perfume that smells good on you, then that becomes your branded perfume, you know, your smell. I know my mom from a million miles away for years just because of the perfume she loves to use, you know. Well, this woman is like that as well, and they were getting ready to stop making one of her favorite products, and so she bought up the store of all the product that she loves so much. She started doing this over and over again, and she found ways now to resell a lot of that product for premium pricing, and there are actual Facebook groups and forums that talk about, hey, how to find that perfume that's totally out of sale. Of course, eBay is always one of those places. I'm sure you guys have actually sourced some product like that. It's out of stock, but people still love to buy it. Well, that's what she did. And guess what? Now the manufacturer of these products are doing something where they're bringing back old product, specifically in limited runs, based on the conversations that these brands are hearing in social media about the affinity that certain small markets have around that product. It's really interesting what is going on, because now big brands can have micro markets because they're able to hear what's going on in social media around their brands. That's why I'm saying the biggest thing you can do in social media is to listen, because once you listen, you know where the fish are. I used to go out with my grandfather to go fishing, and he would drive me crazy because we would move from here, then to here, then to here. And I'm like, Granddad, why can't we just stay here? It's like in the shade, you know. He's like, because we need to fish where the fish are. And the problem is we're doing these spray and pray kind of things, and we're not fishing where the actual fish are. Here's a great tool for listening across multiple social platforms. It's called social mention. Write that one down. It's very similar to our next listening tool, which is the granddaddy of them all, Google Alerts. Social mention, you can create mention alerts around your brand or products and get them emailed to you. Google Alerts has the same thing going on, but it does that around searches on Google. Kiss tested, mother approved, the granddaddy of them all. It's been out forever and still underserved and underused by many. Absolutely fantastic. You put in a word, it's basically going to search Google every day for your keyword. You can have it delivered to you via email every week, every month, or every time somebody makes a mention of it. So create some alerts. Start playing around with this so you can see what's going on and what's being talked about around your product or your brand. I don't know if you caught this at the beginning where I was talking about some of the things that we've sold, but one of the things that we do sell are bandanas. And I know that, and everybody knows this, man. If you make it to the front page of Google, you're in it to win it, you know? And I mean, if you make it to the top two spots on Google, you are in the golden era of commerce, you know? I mean, there's no better place to be than at the top of search. Well, I wanted to rank at the top of search for bandanas. And a simple look over on SpyFu about how much these guys are paying for ads on bandanas was astonishing to me. $400 to $800 a day for the number one spot for wholesaleforeveryone.com. The number two spot was paying $400 to $1,000 a day, and the number three spot was paying $600 to $1,700 a day. Let me say that again, a day on pay-per-click budgets. Well, you know what? I'm like, dude, no thanks. I can't even compete in that field. So you know what I did? I just pulled out my trusty little camcorder, which I got on Amazon for $72. It was a Prime product, so I got free shipping on it. Yes, I love free shipping, except for when I have to do it myself to other people. But when it's coming to me, I want my free shipping. So I'm a Prime member, and I got my Vado. I pulled it out. I put it on a stand, and I made a video on how to fold a bandana. And the deal was, I looked around there for bandana folding videos, and how did I know that I wanted to make a video on how to fold bandanas? Because I did my keyword research, and not only that, I knew that people kept asking me after I sold them a bandana how to fold it different ways. So hey, why not make a video on that? You created the video, and I looked at the other videos in the market, and I'm like, dude, that's the other how to fold a bandana video? I think I can make a better video than that. So that's all I had to do. I had to just beat this guy. The only thing I needed to do to beat this guy was basically turn on the lights in the room. I mean, this is the worst video. Oh, and I decided to iron my damn bandana before I took a picture of it. But he didn't. So that was the one I had to beat. And I don't know if I could go backwards. We'll see if I can go back. Yeah. But if you look at my video, it has 223,000 views of it. 223,000 views of it. His has 141,000 views of it. Yeah, look, I ain't mad at him. You know, that's a great number too. You know? But the thing is that his video and my video are top slot. If you go out right now and search for how to fold a bandana, I show up before those guys that are spending $400 to $1,700 a day just to be at the top. You feel me? That's why I love video. And that's why I'm saying that video is one of the strongest ways to get results out of social media, simply because it can get you to the top of search, and being at the top of search is how you make money. look at the traffic of this video from the day we started until today. This was taken, as you can see, on 5/16/12. That was yesterday. And that curve is never ending. It's never dipped. Every day we are seeing hundreds of people come to our site every week. You know, let's say every week we see hundreds of people come to our site through this video. It's absolutely insane. I even got an order this week for, what was it, 45,000 units. 45,000 units, and they told me on the phone, how'd you hear about it? We found your video. We saw you on that video. Really? Wow. Converting. That's the important part of having this kind of social model. Now, you ask me, John, where should I start? Don't forget what I'm saying, blogging. First, you got to get a blog. Do that first. That's going to yield you the best results, because if somebody is looking for your business, and let's say you already have, well, I got a store. Yep, that's cool. You want a store, that's your shopping cart. The blog is not your shopping cart. You know what the blog is? The blog is the thing that validates your shopping cart. If you think that people are going to buy from you without going there and searching your name in Google before buying from you, you are possibly misrepresenting yourself. People want to know that you are a legitimate business, and seeing that you have a blog presence legitimizes your store presence. So if you're going to spend the time to do something, forget all the other things. Start with the blog, which is the hub, the central area of what we're trying to do. I like blogs, so I'm going to give you the good, the better, and the best. Blogger. Blogger's good. It's owned by Google. It's good. Reason why I don't like it as much, and why it's only getting the good seal, is because it doesn't have all of the plugins and flexibility that I like to have. Better than Blogger, in my opinion, is Tumblr. Why do you think Tumblr is better, John? Well, it's got even less plugins than Blogger does, and it's not owned by Google. However, it's got a strong community around it, and it's very easy to use your cell phone to simply take snippets and post them out on a Tumblr blog. Tumblr is a very powerful platform, not necessarily in technology, but in community. And if you have a business that is dependent on community, Tumblr is one of those places you really should be looking at getting a presence on. So that's the better one. And the best one is WordPress. As a matter of fact, it's so good that I have to put a ring on it. You know? It's heavenly. I love WordPress. WordPress has the flexibility of being able to set it up in the manner that you want, where it can carry across your brand, but also it has the back-end plugins that will literally automate the process to get your content pushed to all the other social networks. All the other social networks. You can create one single post on a WordPress.org version of WordPress and have it push to all your other social mentionable products or platforms. So that's why I like WordPress the best. So we're going to stop doing what we've been doing, which is fire, ready, aim, and we are going to go in and start doing getting ready first, then aiming, and then firing. That is what is going to really, really amp up your business. And let me just, before I go, give you one thing that I don't think can be beat. And social media does this better than any other platform in terms of marketing. What social media does is give you influence. It helps to influence people on a purchase. If you are into tennis shoes, and one of your buddies says, hey, check out these cool purple tennis shoes, which I do have the purple pair now, you know. I was like, oh, my gosh, I'm into purple. I got to get those purple tennis shoes. And I know that those shoes are cool to get because my buddy said that these are some cool shoes. So he's done all the work. He's already taken the time to find out if these shoes really work, if they are going to last, if these guys are a reputable business, way before he would post it. How do I know that? Because he's my friend, and I trust him. So he has influence over the purchasing decisions that I make. And you can only get that in social media. I'm loving this. Burberry. These guys have this thing called the Art of the Trench. You can go to burberry.com and check it out. It's one of their social media platforms. It has that Pinterest feel. But what they are doing is what we talked about in the beginning is, like, it's not about people just talking about your products. These people have already purchased their products, and now they're talking about it. And Burberry is giving them a place to do that. And people are posting their pictures inside of their Burberry quotes. And it's absolutely a fantastic marketing platform for those guys. What they're doing is they're understanding the loyalty loop. And I'm really big on finding what works in big business and teasing it down so that I can use it in my small business. But look at this loyalty loop. Where are people actually at in the buying phase? Are they evaluating? Are they ready to buy? After they bought, how can you use social media either while they're buying or after they're buying to enhance that buying experience? How can, after they've had the buying experience, you use social media to turn those people into advocates for your brand, which will actually help engage people that are considering or evaluating to buy that same product? And you see that? It goes around and around. And the more times it goes around, the stronger the bond, the stronger the bond. And that's what we want people to be, totally bound to our brand. That brand can be the experience that we give them or the products we give them. These are a couple of individual touch points in that loyalty loop. All right? So this, you're going to get the slides, as you said. I want you to go through it and really think about how you can use these tactics in the steps that the consumer might be in during their decision journey. I hope I've given you enough stuff so that you will stop doing what we have seen others do, and we'll start getting into what is very much targeted social marketing instead of just going out there spraying and praying. This stuff works. I guarantee this stuff works. I've seen it work. I've worked with people that make it work, and I study how well it works. So trust me. Oh, yeah. And one more thing, of course, for those of you who know, it's an homage to my boy. Give the customer what they want? No. Our job as e-commerce marketers is to figure out what they want before they do. My name is John Lawson. I'm from Colder Ice, and I think we've got a few minutes left for a couple of Q&A.
I love the new self-portrait, John. Awesome.
Yeah, thanks.
I have to hand it to you. You give the best presentations. You have it right on the mark, and I love your pictures of bullets. Bullets are going through crayons and all kinds of stuff. Very cool. We do have some Q&A and some great questions, and I think Karen's here with those for us.
And
I am.
Before you go, can you make sure John gets in? I don't know.
Yeah, John, are you here?
I'm right here.
All right. Fantastic. So, guys, let me just tell you who John is. John is my business partner in this Going Social. And, John, you can give him a little bit about the consulting firm and the things that you do, sir.
Sure. Well, I run Gulf Blue Consulting, and I've been working with John for several years now. And we're in the process of developing this Going Social education series that we keep talking about. And, going social is John's passion, and, I'm just here to be supportive and to bring my consultancy experience to the table so that we can help great people like you do better with your business, grow your top-line revenue, and, of course, grow that bottom line profitability. That's what we're here to help you do.
Cool. Shoot.
Cool. All right. The first question came in at the very, very beginning of the whole webinar. How important is pricing of your products?
To social media, it's not.
That was an easy one. Great.
That's an easy one. I mean, that's not relevant. I know what they're trying. I mean, pricing is very important to the product. However, I think we overemphasize pricing, because underpricing, I believe, is worse than overpricing. And I think a lot of us have been in this area of underpricing, and we've got into this Chinese manufacturing kind of mindset where we're underpricing everybody, we're driving down our revenue stream, and then we're wondering why we keep seeing people going out of business, because we have removed what is most important to the customer is not the price, but it is the experience, it is the quality of the product, and the service that they get. And we don't understand it the way we should, but we're actually seeing it right now as people are starting to run away from the low-cost leaders. I mean, Walmart has had its troubles because they're seeing their prices needing to go back up, because people actually think about price when they're thinking about value of the product. And so when they see cheap prices, they think cheap product. So you've got to be on the cusp.
It's that perception thing. I actually had that happen yesterday. I listed something and it sold in 10 minutes, and I'm like, darn, I listed that too low. I had to have. The next question was, when you showed that marketers using social media listing, Pinterest was not on the list.
Absolutely not. Pinterest is way too new. I know we love new. I know we love shiny. And I know it's been in the news, and that's why everybody thinks it's just the greatest thing. And it is a great thing. But it is way too new. So we can't take data out of something that's been around basically for 6 months and say that's something that we're, you know, especially with that, that was a Forrester research, and that's enterprise brands. And so they're not able to really speak to how important Pinterest might be in the future. It's still new. That's why it's not on there yet.
Awesome. But it's definitely worth taking a look at, as you, evidenced by the free ebook. Thank you very much for giving the audience access to that.
Yeah, that was another thing, too. I don't want to spend a lot of time on it because it's the new shiny thing, but it's like, here, take the book. Go grab that.
Well, we appreciate that. And that, again, that link for any of the listening to us download, it would be goingsocial@colderice.com. Is that right, John?
That's right. The name of this thing, goingsocial.colderice.com.
Well, and it was interesting that Pinterest was big in the news today with the whole thing about Rakuten's buy-in of it. So it'll be interesting to see how that all goes. Next question. So we need two different accounts, one for communicating with other sellers and one for potential buyers and for our buyers. That was a question from Dell.
Do we need two?
Separate social media accounts. One, you know, so we can chat with each other as sellers, and one for talking with buyers and potential buyers.
Well, I mean, let's look at the platforms. I don't think you need two Facebook IDs. I mean, you have your personal Facebook ID, and then you have your fan page or your, you know, timeline for your business. So that would be one, you know, ID. When it comes to Twitter, I would... Yeah, I'd probably say that there's room for two, although I don't know if people are going to follow your brand when you're a small, you know, mom and pop, but it doesn't hurt to have it that way, where you're actually just focusing on the products that are coming out of your business. What do you think about that, John?
Well, I agree with what you're saying. I mean, you know, as you said about Facebook, you know, you do want to make sure you have your business's page you know, set up the right way so you can kind of carry your brand forward, rather than just saying, hey, here's me on Facebook, you know, find me on Facebook. Because one of the challenges with that, and what some of the things that some past clients have experienced, is they thought, hey, I'll just use my Facebook, you know, my personal Facebook page, and, you know, let customers know about that. all of a sudden your mad customer comes on, they start doing spammy, spam, spam a lot with, bad things that they're trying to say or whatever, and it just turns into a nightmare. So I agree with the separation you mentioned there, but regarding Twitter feeds, I mean, if you have something where you want to be able to tweet out to your family and you don't want that going to your business followers, sure, you can make a separate Twitter ID there.
Yeah, that's true too. Cool.
And those are really the only social media relevant questions. The last question is, there are so many e-commerce stores out there to purchase. What would be a good e-commerce store to start with?
Here's the deal. My thing is, I would make a list of the must-have things that you want in a store, all right? Because there are so many different flavors of a store. The first thing I would do is just say, well, these are the things I definitely want to make sure that my store has. And then, Matt, do a goal match. It's like narrow down the numbers to the ones that have the things that you want and go from there. That's almost like asking, what kind of a tennis shoe, the one that feels the best, which one's going to make me jump higher? Actually, none of them. And that's the real deal. And so now we can open it up to any question. I didn't want to say that, but I was thinking about something else with the pricing thing. But okay. If you have any other ones, that's cool too.
Fantastic. And speaking of tennis shoes, Beth Tchaikovsky wants to know if you got a chance to look at the new tennis shoes on eBay from her friend, who are actually purple Converse sneakers with a 4-inch heel.
We've already talked about this heel thing. I don't want sneakers with heels.
Oh, okay. She just wanted to know if you've seen those.
But I've seen a lot of them with heels, yes. It's crazy.
New trend there. Interesting question from Eileen White about the ebook. How many pages is that ebook? She thinks perhaps her download was incorrect. Do you have an idea how many pages are in the Pinterest ebook so she can check her download? John Miller, maybe you know that or could look for that for us.
I don't know. Karen, how many pages are in it?
I don't know.
It's like 8 pages. It's not that long.
Okay, well, she's saying that page 13 is where it ended on her, but it got cut off, and so she's thinking maybe her download.
That's right, 13. I do remember, 13 pages.
Awesome, check it out.
And we have a question from Chris Taylor. What's the biggest social marketing mistake you made, John, and what did you learn from it?
The biggest social marketing mistake I ever made was arguing with somebody in social media. I will never do that again. I did that a long time ago on Twitter. We did a little back and forth, and I learned my lesson that day. Never, ever do that. And then I watched somebody else do it and got to you never win because it hurts and damages your own credibility. So it's one of those, when you argue with stupid, nobody can tell the difference.
Arguing with idiots.
Yeah.
That sounds like a really good story. So that you think that was your biggest mistake? Is that a mistake you see other newbies to social media making, or what's the most common mistake you see a newbie making when they make their first foray into social media?
Spam. Just think about this, man. If you started right now and you opened up your own Gmail or Yahoo Mail or any of these mail accounts, and you immediately started spamming people with emails about your products, how fast would you be banned from that email platform? Very quickly. Mm-hmm. We know spam is bad, but the fact that we can do it kind of almost anonymously or with the push of a button has allowed people to think it's okay to constantly spam their thread. And what ends up happening is that you create a brand in people's mind. And that mind is that everything this guy says is a spam message. People don't like spam. Let me tell you what people like. We love to buy stuff we hate to be sold to.
Well said. Okay, so the most common mistake you see a newbie making is spamming folks, just going out there and say, okay, John said I have to be here, so I'm going to come on here and tell you all the stuff I'm selling, right?
Yeah. You become that person at the party that everybody wants to move away from. You're the insurance salesman now. Mm. Oh, do you need some insurance? You know, I sell insurance. Here's my card, you know.
Don't be that guy.
Don't be that guy.
All right, John, so you had everybody in the palm of your hand. They were following all along. They were awesome. They were really buying into everything. And then you said, you have to have a blog. And about half of them went, oh, no. So reach out to our audience that's saying, I don't want a blog. I don't know what to say. I have nothing to say. And tell them, give them some encouragement on starting a blog. Could you do that?
First, starting a blog is easy, okay? It's very, very simple. Now, I know that there's some, just think about this, guys. If we're on this call and you're seeing it in live action where people are saying, I don't want to blog, that lets you know that you need to be blogging because everybody else is too lazy to do it. And that's why you're going to win. But not only that, the reason why you have to have a blog is because you're not going to rank in keyword search unless you have a static content. Blogs last a long time. Twitter lasts on average about 3 minutes per tweet. That's how much engagement you're going to get. A Facebook post is about 18 minutes at most, wow, where somebody's going to take action once you post it. When you post something to a blog, it's there in perpetuity. Actually, last night while I was doing research, I found the very first blog post I ever wrote, which was a guest blog post on another person's blog back in 2008. It's, wow, still out there. It, yeah, comes up when I search for it. That's why you want a blog. I'm not saying you have to be tied to it and you have to do something every day. No. But when you do something that one time, it's available every day, and that is a big win. Now, John will jump all over you about why blogging is important for e-commerce, so I'm going to let him talk for a sec.
Yeah, I just can't say enough about how important blogs are for, you know, for selling more online. For me, the number one reason, you know, I'm a bottom line guy, and the number one reason is just the SEO juice you get from having a blog. Let me give you a great example. I know somebody who you know, loves to blog about things that she's really into, and she just decided on a whim. She's good at blogging, and it's part of her career. But you know, one of the things she decided to do, there's a television show she's crazy about, and she went to their page on the show's, you know, website to try to find what's their blog. You know, what are they talking about? They didn't have one. So she knows WordPress, and she knows how to make websites, and she knows how to, you know, put things together. So on a whim, spent about an hour and a half, did up some really great design and whatnot, you know, some pretty advanced stuff. But from a blogging standpoint, she set up a very simple blog. And 24 hours later, if you type the name of that show with blog after it, her site was ranked number one on Google, the very top of the very first page of search results, if you type that in there. That is the power of blogging.
Wow.
If you find you've got a product or a product category that you're trying to push products on your site, and if you're blogging about that, again, with the audience in mind, listening to the audience that you have, listening to customers you want, giving them information that's relevant and engaging, but with the right keywords in there, if you find you can't get in the top, you know, page or top two pages of search results, you're going to find that your blog posts about that just almost instantly are on page one, two, or three without spending any money. It's just a little bit of the time that you have to invest to listen to your audience so that you know how to talk to them about that product or product category. So, you know, blogs are it. There's a reason that blogs sit in the center of the going social dandelion model that John was showing you, you know, in the webinar tonight.
Yeah.
So we
this is kind of freaky. People ask me why I'm calling myself Colder Ice, right? And it was really, I made it up because my name was so common. If you put in John Lawson into Google back in 2008, you'd get about 4 million results. And I just was like, you know, there's just no way that I would ever be able to compete with those 4 million results. I started a blog. If you put in John Lawson today, I'm in the top five in two of those slots because of my blog. Now, if that is not enough proof for you, I'd out of 4.8 million results for a common name like John Lawson, I'm in the top two spots of the five spots available. The other three are Wikipedia. I'm going to beat Wikipedia one day for my name.
I know you will. I know you will.
So since we're talking about blogs, the next questioning came through is, what do you blog about?
People. I love that question. That is why I say, ready, aim, fire. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to find the audience and we're going to listen. That audience will tell us exactly what we need to blog about. For an example, I do e-commerce. I've got the group, the e-commerce group. If I just never said anything in that group and just listened to the conversation, listened to the questions that people are asking other members, I'd know exactly what I should blog about. Because blogging about that, if it's an interest for those people talking, it's going to be an interest for other people as well. So questions that they ask and issues that they have in these kind of conversations are what you end up blogging about. And you'll be very interested to figure out. I know that stuff because I sell that product. I already know that stuff. So just blog and answer that question.
John, would you say that it's sometimes easier for some folks to think about a blog as a conversation? And if we were all together standing around at a cocktail party having a conversation, most people have an opinion about most things. Find something that's being talked about that you feel strongly about one way or the other, or that you have an opinion about, and blog about.
Right. You know, another thing is, too, don't overthink blogging. I think people, we've got into this thought that you have to be a writer to blog. When blogs started, there were no writers that were blog writers. There was no such thing. It was just people talking. And you're right. That's all it is. Have that conversation. You'll get better as time goes on. Don't worry about getting good. Just get started, and you'll get better. If I went back and looked at the stuff that I wrote back in the day, oh, my God, it's garbage. But, hey, people loved it, you know, because I was having a conversation. And I still can't spell.
We don't care.
I'm not touching that. Yeah. So then we have a couple more questions. For some reason, Chris's questions weren't coming through to me earlier. Oh. Chris Taylor wants to know, how much time do you spend on your social marketing each day, and how do you schedule it in, earlier or late in the day?
You know, to be honest, I'm kind of, like I said in the beginning, I got hooked on social media, so I'm like on crack. So I'm not a good measure. You know, I'm all over the place. I'm constantly looking at multitasking. You know, but most things that are important, I get done. Let me say, like right now, I guess if you go on my blog site every Monday, I post up something called the Monday Morning Infograph. Mm-hmm. I do that once a month. I set those up on a timeline, and those just push out automatically. Like I said also, I'll go on the weekends and create two or three blog posts and push those out on my time. So I would really say that on my blog, I spend probably 2 hours a week at most, and then the other time is just me hanging out in Twitter or Facebook, mostly Facebook. I'm just hanging out.
John, just to follow up on that, one of the things that we noticed recently, we had done a survey of the folks in our e-commerce group on Facebook, and people talked about the fact that, number one, one of their biggest challenges is not having enough time to get everything done. So, you know, Chris's question is a really pertinent question. One of the other things that we found is that of the people that are spending any time or energy, going social with their e-commerce business, the majority of those folks said, look, the ROI is very high. Now, the rest of the people who said that the ROI is not, is not high is because they didn't know how to measure it. So either people didn't know how to measure the return on their time investment or their dollar investment, or they found they were getting a really good return for the time that they spent. So my point here is that the time is well spent. It is important to carve out a little bit of your time, whether it's every day or every week, to make sure that you are going social with your business. So great question from Chris.
Great answer.
That was a great answer.
Oh, can I just say this, guys? So what he's talking about right now is if you go to colderice.com and go to the blog tab, and it might have another – actually, there's like a slider that goes on that first page on colderice.com. The third slide will be that actual survey that he's referring to, and you can get a copy of that if you participate, and it takes you about 10 minutes, and we're going to give away a BlackBerry playbook to one lucky winner.
I was going to say that survey makes you think too, because as you're answering the questions, I'm like, what do I do? Do I do this? Why do I do that? It does. It helps you figure things out a bit as you're going through it. At least it did me. But we all know I love to blog.
Yes.
Yeah.
I think I'm going to superimpose my face on this guy in the green suit.
Oh, that would be
scary.
I like
the guy in the green suit. I just think that's
Yeah, cute. But John's face on the guy in the green suit would be scary.
Leave the fingers like they are and then put your
Oh, yeah, on. Everything else is staying. Just like...
So we have other questions, Karen. I don't want to leave anybody
no,
out.
No, it looks like that's it. There were some comments about how Seth Godin's blog's posts are short and to the point. And then, John, I figured you'd appreciate this one. Someone posted that
point.
They want... Someone posted that they wanted to say hi, that they're logged in from Australia and actually found your seminars from Google Alerts.
Oh,
she
wow.
She thoroughly loved it.
That was awesome. Bridget. That was Bridget, and I thought that was really appropriate since you were talking about the power of Google Alerts. Other comments I thought you might enjoy, and I always try to pass it along when somebody's complimenting someone else. Allison Jones says, thank you, great presentation. Ray Mitchum says, great presentation, so much good information. Thank you, John. And Joyce Banbury says, lots of great info. Thank you, John. So
Yay.
Really happy audience today.
Thank you, guys. I really appreciate it. It was a lot of fun.
It was.
And Lisa,
thanks so much.
Lisa Emmons says, I enjoy this webinar. I've learned a lot, and I hope you do more like this. Lisa, we'd love to hear from you. Check out the blog at topratedsellerwebinars.com and tell us what you like so much and what you'd like to hear more of. Ishi Stewart also chimes in and says, thank you, John. And since we have two Johns, John Miller, I think we can say thank you, John. John.
Thanks, guys.
We really appreciate both of you being here and all of your time. Michelle Millender is also interesting topic. Great presentation. Thanks to John, Karen, and Kat. Really appreciate your time, John. I know we asked for an hour, and you gave us an hour and a half, and we're really grateful for that. You guys can follow up with John at colderice.com and check out this new area that he's moving into, this Going Social. Very interesting. goingsocial.colderice.com. And definitely go to the blog and register for that BlackBerry playbook. I'd love to know the person who wins that one, John. That would be cool.
Okay, we'll definitely let you know.
Okay. Well, tell us again how they enter that contest, because our guys love the freebies.
Just go to colderice.com, and there's like a slider that goes by, and it'll be the third slide after the eBay slide and the sign up for our list thing.
Fantastic, and then you can get your chance to win a BlackBerry playbook. And I've had several questions about they had trouble logging in, didn't get to hear the whole thing. When will the presentation be up? I will try for faster, but I will guarantee you within 24 hours the presentation will be up on our YouTube channel. Best way for you to find out about that is to sign up for the newsletter at topratedsellerwebinars.com over on the right. Sign up for our newsletter, and we'll keep you informed as soon as we get the slideshow up from John and all the freebie lists and the great links he gave us, Describe Fire, all of that will be on the blog and on the newsletter. So thanks again. You guys have a great weekend. If you enjoyed John's speech today, you can give him a review. Karen's put the link in the chat room. So let folks know how much you enjoyed listening to John. And sign up for the newsletter. We'll see you again next month for Branding Your eBay Business. Bye, everybody.